so interesting about Ethereum, it's everything. You know, I actually bought my first NFT today. And look, everything's priced in.
Congrats. Was it a crypto punk?
You got to tell us more about that, Raoul.
It's nothing exciting. I just thought I'd have to do it. We'll come on to that when we talk about NFTs in a bit. But it was priced at 0.75 ETH. Mm-hmm. So ETH is money. And I'd seen that because we commissioned for Real Vision a kind of headquarters in crypto voxels, which we're just, you know, we're going to release soon, just for the fun of it. And the architects, we paid in ETH, and the land, we paid in ETH. So it's like, okay, well, ETH is clearly money, but ETH is technology. We know that too. ETH is also a platform of which people are building a lot of different applications. So whether we talk about community tokens, NFTs, DeFi, a whole bunch of stuff, DAOs, they're all going to be on ETH. Now, will ETH be the only chain? No, clearly. People use Solana for stuff. People use, and there'll be a multi-chain world of which there'll be a few giants and a long tail of stuff. And that's pretty normal. But ETH has got really interesting because of this. And then, you know, I came out with a piece in Global Macro Investor last month called The Greatest Trade. And, you know, here's my macro head on again, is okay, we've got this adoption of that is kind of exponential, right? It's growing at least twice the rate of Bitcoin. And it's by far dwarfing the rest of the space. Then the EIP 1559 comes along and that reduces the supply. So that's clearly bullish for the price. And then you look at the on-chain analytics and everyone is bloody staking it because now it's a pretty clear run between now and ETH 2.0. So why would you not if you're a long-term holder? So everybody's staking it. So that's taken a ton of stuff off the exchange. There's tons that have gone into just holding, tons that are locked up in DeFi, tons that are locked up in NFTs. And you're left with, I don't know, as of today, 11% of the entire supply of Ethereum available, and it's going down every day. And the demand is going exponential. The only outcome is an exponential rise in price. There's no other outcome.
So I just want to talk briefly about what sort of network effects you look at. I know I've seen some of your Twitter threads, and it's been great. Is it address adoption? Is it number of holders? What is it?
Doesn't really matter. There's a lot of macro guys that will be annoyingly kind of hand wavy. Like if it's being adopted at speed, it's going to work. And everyone's like, well, what exactly can I model that in a spreadsheet? No, forget about it. It's irrelevant. If you look at the rate of adoption that's going on of the entire crypto space. And this is my true north. This is all I need to know. There's one single thing I need to know and nothing else. So we know that it's growing at 113% a year in terms of number of users. And we will assume that over time, that trend rate of growth falls a bit. So if it falls from this year and goes down to 83%, so that's a significant fall in the growth rate. And we saw the internet do similar, but it was at peak growth was 63%. We're at 113. It gets by the end of 2024 to 1 billion people. And that gets us to about 3 or 4 billion people by 2027, 28. Okay, so a blind chimp can choose a cryptocurrency and get rich. If you look at the size of the assets, the entire crypto space as of today hit at 2 trillion again, I think. Global equities are about 200 trillion. Global bonds are like 200 trillion. Global real estate's about 100 trillion, 2 trillion, 200 trillion. I figure that's probably 100x. And we all know, almost all of us realize that all bonds, all securities, all assets are going on chain anyway. So it's probably even bigger than that. But the point being is that you'll never ever in your entire life ever again and ever beforehand were given 100x in an asset that's already up 2,000,000% when you look at Bitcoin. You've never been given that. And you can basically choose anything and it will go up. So once you do that, you're not scared of making the wrong bet. And it's stops you being tribal because within that, you know, some of them are going to be amazing. You take the pressure off, you take some basic bets, you know, Bitcoin, Ethereum, a couple of others here and there, and then you can just have a basket of stuff and over time decide, okay, I quite like that, or that's getting faster adoption. So then you start to look at like Solana is clearly getting adoption. It's clearly happening and it's clearly happening in the price. Okay, so do you want to own a bit more of that? Maybe, you know, is Polkadot getting to where it should be? Don't know yet, but it's worth keeping an eye on. You know, there's a lot of stuff. And then, so that's how I tend to deal with it, is forget trying to model it and look for fair values and this. It's like, as I said, you can be a three-year-old kid and be given a box of names of cryptocurrencies and take 10 out and you will literally make 30 times your money over the next 20 years. And next 10 years.
But why have you singled out Ether and Ethereum as the world's greatest trade? Well, what about the adoption
of Ethereum? So this is the typical way I'll approach macro, and a lot of macro guys do. You've got this big thesis now, which is 100x the space in the shortest period of time. So then our job is, okay, how do I add alpha? Where do I find the better bets? Now, there will be probably 50 tokens or assets that will outperform Ethereum, but they're riskier. Mm-hmm. I don't know what they are. I have no ability to choose them. When you look at Ethereum, it has all of the elements of the lowest risk, highest quality trade. And it's, you know, it's a rewarding ecosystem with rewarding people in it, because, you know, there's a social element to this, there's a cultural element to this movement as well. And it's rewarding. So it's a good space to hang out where you feel comfortable with the asset. You understand how many smart people are working on it. So when you say to me, oh, there's a risk in 1559 getting done, my answer was the risk is like minuscule. And so I didn't care about it. Like ETH 2.0, it's minuscule. Why? Because there's a lot of very smart people, smarter than I'll ever be, working on it. So the probability is extremely high. And that's what makes ETH so rewarding.
So let's talk about some of the catalysts coming up for ETH then, right? So we talked about EIP 1559. We talked about staking. Is the merge as well part of the calculus, right? Because we're going to see this triple point, this three-part halvening. We're going to see like a massive reduction in supply. Is this the bull case? Is it mainly from the supply side or is there a demand side?
Knowing how markets work, this is going to catch a lot of people by surprise. It is all in the run-up where the money will be made. My guess is the moment ETH 2.0 happens, half of the ETH gets unlocked and it all comes onto the market. And the price will collapse. It's typical. Yeah. And that's a short-term thing. It might be an overhang for a year. I mean, who the hell knows, right? But that's pretty obvious that this is the best single time. That's why I call it the greatest trade between now and ETH 2.0. Everybody wants it to happen. They're going to lock up as much ETH as possible and get the yield. It's as simple as that. But when it comes out, chance ETH collapses. If you remember when Coinbase went public, everyone's like, this is so good for the space. Everyone's going to know about it. What did it do? Marked the exact high in Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. And I've mentioned that on Twitter beforehand. I'm like, this is what it's going to do, and it will. And this will probably mark the high in ETH.
Well, I have a counter argument for that, if you are interested in hearing it.
Yeah, absolutely.
The people that are staking ETH right now, they're committing to that insolvency period, right? Like, it's the whole point. As soon as the merge happens, that insolvency period is up and they can withdraw. That's what you're talking about. The nature of proof of stake is that it actually rewards people who are the most bullish. Right. And so the people that are committing towards that lockup period are the people that are inherently long on the Ethereum economy. And so while and Ether definitely appreciated significantly since some of these, amounts of Ether got locked up. And so by definition, there will be people who want to, you know, realize those gains, but they are also going to be the population of people that are most inherently tied to the health of Ethereum itself. And they're most interested in the long-term success of Ethereum. So if there's any population of people that's not going to dump right after the unlock period happens, it's the people who are ready to take a year of insolvency.
And that doesn't matter. It's the marginal change that matters. Mm. Right now, the marginal change is more and more people locking up ETH, right? The rate of change of people locking up is still extremely high. What will happen is the rate of change of people staking will fall. It's as simple as that. You know, the bull case is that, of course, there's a load of people who are just going to stake and just leave it there. And that's good because that's the long-term health of the system. You know, nobody's in this for the quick buck, but there's a shit ton of people, yourselves included, who will end up selling some ETH because they want to buy a house or get married or do all the stuff that costs fiat money.
Buy some NFTs though, you know, maybe that, maybe just that.
Maybe, but at some time you're going to spend some fiat money on something.
Bro,
it could be NFTs.
What's your preferred narrative for Ethereum? So, and then do you have a different narrative for ETH? The asset, right? There's all of these different narratives.
I think people trying to overthink everything. You know, ETH currently is a platform, you know, that's how I think about it. You know, it's a platform from which to utilize their blockchain to transfer value, to store value, and to create applications on top. So, you know, is elements of it money, as we talked about? Yes. Are elements of store of value? Yes. Are elements pure technology? Yes. I mean, it's everything. So, you know, it kind of is still the vision that Vitalik had of the kind of internet computer. It is that, but that sounds a bit restrictive. It's kind of I call it the internet of value, and you could call it the platform of value. And it's not exclusive because others can do similar things, but nothing has the scale, the scope that Ethereum currently has.